Are you stuck? What about unhappy? Join Alena Chapman, author, mentor, and life coach, for 30-minute moments as she challenges you to get out of the doldrum and start living your life to the fullest. It's time to celebrate that life with 30-minute moments.
Welcome to 30-Minute Moments. I'm your host, Alena Chapman, and as you know, this show is all about ease and flow in your life, because when you have ease and flow, you're calm, you have fun, and you can achieve with just so much grace. So today, we're going to be talking to Patrick Riley. Now, I have to tell you a little bit about Patrick, because he's pretty darn cool. He's currently a co-host on a digital talk show called The Happy Hour on Facebook and YouTube. I have watched this. It is so much fun, and it brings up real topics. I really like that, Patrick. The entertainment and pop culture journalist is also inside a spring and summer 2019 promotional tour for his hardcover book. Yay! It's called That's What Friends Are For, and it's on the women who inspired me. I love that. You can get that on Barnes & Noble and Amazon, everywhere that books are sold. NABJ deemed it outstanding literary work. Very cool. As the NYC New York City Pride Organization awarded him its 2018 Trailblazer Award honor in Harlem. Very nice. And then Patrick, an independent producer, personality, and writer, is perhaps best known for his work as a freelance senior field producer at the Oprah Winfrey Show. Love that show. For over 13 years, including ABC Network credits on Oprah's Legends Balls and Building a Dream and the Oprah Winfrey Leadership Academy. The Morehouse College graduate has also been seen or can be seen on a camera contributor on Daily Blast Live, TV's One's Life After, Cozy TV Bet, The Advocate, Wells Fargo, and Arise Entertainment 360. He is a mover and shaker. And his name is Patrick Riley, and I want to bring you on right now. So, how are you, Mr. Patrick?
I am fabulous, Elena. This is such a pleasure to be on with you. I just mentioned that I'm such a fan of your frequency. I think we need more of what you're reflecting on. So I'm happy to be a reflection of that on this episode.
Well, you are a reflection of this. You, my dear, are a true trailblazer and a powerhouse. I mean, I'm looking at everything you do. Now, as you know, this 30-minute moment is all about ease and flow, right?
Yes.
So my question for you is, with all this trailblazing and everything you do, I mean, it's stressful. It has stuff. How do you keep that ease and flow in your life?
You know, I follow my bliss, if you will, and I've done that from the womb. From being a child, I always was moved by things that sparkled, but then yeah. I always knew that all that glitters wasn't gold. So I was always interested in knowing what lied beneath the idols of my childhood, like Diana Ross, or, you know, even Oprah. I would go on to work for her, as you mentioned in my intro, but I would be sort of this rare young kid who got excited by rushing home from school to see that 4 o'clock Oprah Winfrey show. You know what I mean?
How cool. So, yes, yes.
So I was in touch with that sensitivity early on as a child, and I challenged myself to attract a career where I could be in that frequency. It has not been a perfect life or a perfect career, but because I do what I'm called to do, I am able to navigate through life's challenges with ease because I chose joy first. And joy is entertainment and pop culture and all those things that you spout off that are the way that I make my living.
You know, it is interesting. You and I alike. I mean, I'm the girl who always thought things should be fun.
Yeah.
Now, you know, and if they're not fun, then I have to make them fun, or why do it? That has always been my philosophy.
Yeah.
And there is something to this. I think, don't you feel, Patrick, that when we're in some, you and I both, when we're in something that we don't like and we can't make fun and we can't find joy, we're just, we naturally just repel from it.
Absolutely. But I have to offer that because there's so much that we can repel from in this society, I mean, on any given day, you
can
click on your timeline on Facebook.
And you
wish for a way to stay connected to that.
Yes, you do. Yes.
It can bring you down. What I have learned in some life work, it's a great life course that I took, Momentum Education, there's a phrase that I was taught, and it's choose what you resist. So sometimes beyond the repelling, I have chosen what I resist and found a way to sprinkle that joy dust in there.
Yeah, I do that too.
And make the experience tolerable and to, you know, find a way to button it up and maybe move on if it doesn't service you for the long haul, that kind of thing, you know?
Yes, yes, and I have done that too. Yes, yes. I have done things I've had to do.
Yes.
But eventually, I always get back to the core.
Yes.
And that's what it's about.
It is.
And
it is.
You kind of knew your core from the beginning, and most of us do. It's going back and finding it sometimes. What was it that just set our soul on fire? And when you are with people, do you ever, you know, help them to unlock that inside? Just friends, just in conversation. Do you see how people change when they start to find that joy?
I for certain do. And I do use my testimonial in that regard. Because, you know, for me, as you point out, the very women I would go on to be able to interview and produce and promote and in some instances even call them my friends is rooted in a love I had for them from the womb, if you will.
Oh,
you know,
if
it sparkled like Diana Ross or Lola Valana or Donna Summer, I was all in.
Yeah.
And there were moments there where my siblings would have had me, this strange little boy who loves his divas. They would prefer I go out and play with the other little boys, but I needed to stay and be in space and place to see that next Diana Ross airing of the HBO concert. You know what I mean?
What was that?
What is wrong with this strange little kid? So my testimonial usually is, If it really beats your heart and it you should stick with it and you should quiet those doubting voices. Because had I listened to the inauthentic voices of external, you know, critics.
Sure. You
I might have not had the chance to see my way to my destiny, you know, that I had, you know, fortunately gotten in touch with at a young age. And I think more people than not are in touch with what they love and what they're passionate about at a young age. And it is important that you sort of stay the course of that interest. You know, I had to navigate that, you know.
Yes, you do. You have to.
You know, I had to navigate that as a little black boy from Savannah, Georgia.
Yeah. Oh, Savannah. Yeah.
No slice for me that reflected me other than what I saw, you know, when I looked at my divas. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we know I hadn't seen a Broadway show, but there was something about this Dreamgirls album that was the soundtrack of the Broadway.
Oh, I remember.
81. Yeah. I'm 10 years old, and I'm enamored with everything that's on that vinyl that's coming out of that. But I've not seen it. Do you get what I'm saying?
I totally get it. Yes, yes.
This year, hosting an amazing event that I have now been called to host 4 years in a row, the Vanguard Awards. It's a big LGBT music fest that takes place this year in Cancun.
Oh, how
fun. Last year we were in the Dominican Republic, and I got to tribute Cheryl Lee Ralph, the original Dina in Dreamgirls on Broadway.
Wow.
Let her know what she meant to me, because what she meant to me cut through a record. It wasn't even the visual yet. It wasn't even the person that I would grow to know over these years, having interviewed her for great magazine articles and the like. So thank goodness I didn't shift from my pointed vision that I had then.
Yes,
I know. Have had that moment just, you know, 4 months ago.
It would have never come into being, and you would have missed out, you know?
So I testify to everybody all around, and I do it with all ranges of groups. I'm a big mentor with NABJ, you mentioned. That's the National Association of Black Journalists. I work very closely with a lot of young students coming up, helping them in these times define who they are to this industry that is evolving.
It's evolving,
you know,
big time.
I was doing the whole brand thing well before social media and before it was done. So by the time all of those things came into play, I was considered a pioneer in that world where many of my colleagues are dinosaurs. So you got to catch up with what's going on right now. But I had been kind of doing that all along.
That's very
cool. So maintaining a freelance status, for example, with The Oprah Show, a great, wonderful, lucrative time of high-profile assignment after assignment, dream assignment after dream assignment. But I maintained my independence for a reason, because I knew that The Oprah Show wasn't going to be around forever.
You know? Very smart. You're very smart. It's almost, you know, you have strategy.
Yes.
And that's what a lot of people don't really think about. Strategies.
They don't think about it, and
very
they don't
important.
Think about, per se, connecting it to that thing that is their passion. You know, if I you know, there
yes.
were times in my trajectory where I had the makings of, you know, I had to study journalism. So to study journalism, you don't always cover entertainment and pop culture, even though it was in my Jones very authentically from the womb. My dad, the retired Chief Master Sergeant from the Air Force, says Patrick's ambitions have always been felt since he was young. My dad would take me to the library. I always wanted the books on the divas.
He'd
say, get a book on sports. I'd say, I really don't want another book on Ruby Dee or Bessie Smith or Billie Holiday. And so dad, you know, he couldn't do anything about it. He loved that I was reading, you know?
Right. You take what you can.
Absolutely. So now, you know, as these, you know, he's 83 years old, he couldn't be more proud of everything that's going on.
Sure.
But my point is, I tell the young journalists, I speak to gay straight alliances all over New York and the tri-state area here in this area, and I let those kids know, you know, that are in touch with who they say they are and who they believe they are, go with that, you know.
Go with that, always.
But I waited until my mid-20s to have that comfort. And then I did it to the world on The Oprah Show. So that was a whole other thing. My family was like, okay, we know you're gay, but did you have to do it on the show? You know,
that's
that
so
kind of
cool.
thing.
Yeah, no. It's important. It's important. And what you're teaching them is a wonderful guidance. You are listening to 30-Minute Moments, and I'm your host, Alena Chapman, and we are talking with Patrick Riley. We will be right back.
You're listening to 30-Minute Moments with Alena Chapman, helping you discover your true purpose on WoWo and at WoWo.com.
Welcome back to 30-Minute Moments. I'm your host, Alena Chapman, and that ease and betterment, and we are talking to Patrick Riley. I'm now calling him the strategist because I think it's so cool what he has done. But you know what? I want to talk a little bit about your book, Patrick, because you have got one heck of a book. That's What Friends Are For.
On the women who inspired me.
Exactly.
It's really become, I just came home from Georgia where my family is. My brother's like, how are you doing compared to Michelle Obama? I'm like, firstly, it's not a comparison. We're not doing those kinds of things.
No.
Companion. It really is it's part memoir, part entertainment diary. Dorothy Books came and asked if I would just look at my 25 years in the business of having been kind of on the front row of pop culture and entertainment. I feel like the Forrest Gump of the industry in some instances. I've been in a lot of cool rooms over the years.
Wow, how fun.
I wanted you to just unpack that. I have a blog, A Day in the Life of Riley, that has chronicled a lot of these great experiences since maybe 2004, 2003, but coupled with emails since the beginning of email and great diary journals and great pictures, I was able to put together a book that really looks and praises women, primarily black women, at a time where I think women have been marginalized enough, so time's up, and I want to be sort of in as an ally on that movement to celebrate.
Well, thank you. Well, black women, all women, it's important. And
absolutely.
Thank you.
I had the testimonial that supported me doing that, and I also, it became a bit personal in working on the project. That's sort of the biographical piece. I lost my mom when I was 23 years old. And
A
lot of the memories of who she really was were lost in the pain of losing her so young.
Sure. And it's very young.
Hey, the unpeeling and the unlayering has had me land on something so profound that, you know, the average person might say, duh, but I never I thought about it, and it is that my mom was my first diva.
Yes.
She was the first.
Aww, that's so cool.
Woman who sang in the church, so she was like a church diva, you know?
Yes.
Gospel music. My dad traveled us all over the globe. I'm an Air Force brat, so I'm born in Japan. Born in Germany. We lived in California. Before then, they settled down at the end of the late 70s in Savannah. But all those years, so, you know, the Savannah years, you know, it makes sense I would know her as a church singer. But I knew her as a church singer from Japan because she would sing in the chapels.
That's
they would,
very cool.
You know, all of the colonels and everyone knew that my mom was the singer. So her talents went all over the globe the way that my other icon, Diana Ross, does. You know what I mean?
See, she really was. She really was your first
singer. And there was healing in really unpacking all my experiences, not only of having worked with these great women from Diana to Oprah to Tina to Aretha, but also it connected me to the other 25 years of being that kid that has always been in that on that frequency, you know.
Oh no, that's fantastic, and it helps you unfold your mother. That's what it was. It was so cool.
It brought her back in such a palpable way. I did the book tour in Savannah. It was the whole hometown boy makes good kind of thing,
sure,
alongside my 30-year high school reunion, and just the many ways and airwaves and places and spaces I got to speak her name, Queen Elizabeth Bellinger Riley. It was
beautiful.
It was sparkling.
Love that story. I love that story. So now you have this book out and you are traveling and you're doing a book tour. You're getting it out there everywhere.
We're getting it out there on the road, going to everywhere from, you know, black colleges to, as I mentioned, we'll be in Cancun for the LGBT Music Fest. I'm going to be in Dallas May 4th for the Black Arts Roundtable Writers Workshop. They're doing a big to-do with
Very
me
cool.
in Dallas. And we're going wherever they send for me. I was the keynote for North Carolina Central University's African-American Literary Symposium. It was themed Black masculinity in the eras of Obama and Trump. When they called me,
I like that.
You guys know I'm gay. They said, we know you're gay, and we want you to be our keynote. And it was just phenomenal.
That is so cool.
At the HBCU. So I just feel myself kind of a change maker, just in my lane, on my frequency, and I seem to be reflecting that back into a society that needs it right now, if I may just generally say. I know we're
It does. It needs, well, we need a lot of things in our society right now.
Yeah.
But now you reside in New York City. I'm going to be coming out to visit you. You know that.
I'm rocking and rolling on my schedule because I have to see you face-to-face when you come. Tell me what you're going to be.
Oh, gosh. Well, I'm coming out there, and I'm going to be speaking at that 90-second why. And guess what it's about? It's all about how to remain. You know, I came up with this because I love New York City. It's the only place you can go in the world, and I swear everybody wants to just talk, and they're just friendly. I love it.
It's a friendly place, isn't it?
It really is. It really is. But it's also so much energy. And when you're walking, you can get caught up and it can get so busy and you lose that calmness. So I'm talking about how to remain centered and balanced and even lighthearted. And I'm a lot of fun stuff, but I'll tell you the one goal. I'm going to give people this mantra that is so cool that they will always be able to feel that centeredness. And it's actually better than gold. So I do hope you can come.
I want it.
Oh, you're so fun.
Yeah, I'm going to make this happen. And so
it
I
is.
Look to seeing you on
April 29th. Yeah, it's April 29th. So if you're there, oh my gosh, I would be so happy to see you. It is fun. And for all the friends out there, have them come because it'll be a blast.
I look forward to it, and we could all use a boost of joy.
Oh, always joy. And really, that is what it's all about. It's living a life of joy and happiness and just celebrating
and
life.
Channeling that, because again, life's downfalls will happen. They're going to happen. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
Who are we choosing to be along the way?
Oh my gosh. Patrick, that's right on. Say that again. I'm serious.
Life's challenges will be what they will be, but the question is, Who are we choosing to be along the way?
And that's what it is.
And we can call joy worth in many instances and in many ways and spaces, and it is healing,
and it
keeps our frequencies higher, and we need to keep our frequencies higher. We all do.
We do, and it's all about that, and it is a choice.
Yes.
That's what people have to see.
Yeah.
You are listening to 30-Minute Moments with Patrick Riley and your host, Alena Chapman. Guys, that was a gem right there. We will be right back with my favorite part.
This is 30-Minute Moments with Alena Chapman, helping you find your inner self every Sunday on WoWo.
Welcome back to 30-Minute Moments. I'm your host, Alena Chapman. And guys, guess what? It is time. The shift. It is time for that wonderful part of the show that I love, where people have that aha moment, that pivotal moment, where they really say, oh my gosh, I've got a new look on life. So, Patrick, it's your turn. What is your shift, your pivotal moment?
You know, there have been so many along the way.
I know.
My aha moment really came when, in my early 20s, I mentioned I eventually did come out. And I came out to my family in a way that they rejected.
Oh.
And I just, as we are talking about inspiration, my inspiration comes from the divas, the women. It would take me going to a song written by Carol Bayer Sager, but sung by my number one diva, Diana Ross. And it's a song called It's My Turn. And I listened to this lyric. I happened upon the lyric right inside this tension with my family. And the lyric sings, I can't cover up my feelings in the name of love or play it safe. For a while, that was easy. And if living for myself is what I'm guilty of, go on and sentence me, I'll still be free.
She goes on to further expose.
It became the thing I could share that clicked.
Yeah.
So I could, you know, in terms of all the spaces and places that my divas have brought me joy, that I unpack in my book, that I could lean on a lyric as sung by one of them to heal my desire to be my truth to my loved ones is just a miracle to me. And so whenever that song plays, it plays as an anthem for me, because it gave me, it wasn't I'm coming out, it was it's my turn. It gave me the sophisticated verbiage for what it is I was feeling at my core. So, and it was an aha, because it was a song that had been out, but in hearing it in that moment of conflict, it aha'd me into an explanation, and it gave me words that I couldn't say.
Right. You know, it's funny how the universe will give you that when you need it, whether it's in a song, a message, something, but it will come and it will hit your core like it did for you and help you through it.
And I was open to receive it.
That you have to be.
Advice, we're kind of giving some takeaways here. It's being open to receive it. And those moments are everywhere, right?
They are. I do believe that the universe talks to me in songs all the time, because it always answer me. And I think that's because that's where I'm the most open. You know, I'm just listening. So it'll hit me all the time. All through my life, that has been the case. So I totally get what you're talking about.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
You get me.
I get you. So with all this, and I don't want to pass by this, because you're helping people. There are a lot of people, whoever they are, that they hide themselves. They hide themselves. And they can be, it's not only just being gay, but they hide themselves for whatever reason on every front.
A lot of masks. Yeah.
A lot of masks. And it's, you know, they look for inspiration in song. But Patrick, you know, you've been through it. You've been through it's a big transition, or not. It's not a transition for you. It's a transition for everyone else. But for you to take off your mask, I mean, what can you say to people, listeners who may be struggling right now about taking off their mask and being who they truly are, whatever that may be?
Well, I will tell you that for me, as someone who knew I was, you know, designed to be in this business as a personality, a producer, a writer, I thought early on that I wouldn't marry who I am authentically to my career. And so I could always probably be gay, but never not be gay out loud, you know, that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
And
yes.
I can just honestly say that my success improved, increased exponentially after I got true with who I truly am.
Sure.
Not only as a personality, but as a producer, you know, I lost a loved one, a dear man friend in 2005 at a time where as a freelancer you work to, you know, you get paid to work.
Right. Okay.
And it was the person passed away in such a way where I needed to take a beat. And it would be Harpo Productions that would say, give him the time to take his beat, because I was honest about what the loss was and who it was. And I could be exactly who I am. It was a life-changing moment that I might not have gotten working any other place.
Right.
And so just where it pays to simply be honest. I'm now the host of a show called The Happy Hour. You mentioned that.
It's a fantastic show. Fantastic.
Five professional gay guys who are at this time where our voices need to be heard, and to be heard in their multitude. You
yes.
know, we're a diverse array of professional guys who, with our little red table talk-sized episodes, are going to be a part of the conversation that's no different than The View or The Real or The Talk, but we're just bringing our own voices and opinions to what is now the level playing field that is Facebook and YouTube.
Yeah.
And so...
Yeah.
I now know that kind of being who I am helps people. You know, that episode of Oprah, When I Knew I Was Gay, where she asked me to turn the camera on myself and tell my testimonial of coming out.
Wow.
It wouldn't be being ignored by my family that I could focus on for that day that the show aired, contrary to all the many other times I'd been on the show, and it was the biggest deal in the family. That would be the young man who 6 months later told me that it saved his life.
That would make look at that. See, the mask, it cripples you. It cripples you.
It would be the GLAAD award we won for that episode that would make the difference. So I've just learned to quiet those voices that don't speak or reflect the truth and just be all that you can be and see the blessings show up.
I love this. All right. So if anybody wants to find you, how can they? Well, they can find you everywhere. But where's a good place you would like to send people?
Well, you know, to make sure I'm covering all bases, just find me on Instagram at patrick.riley, R-I-L-E-Y. But if you put Patrick Riley in anything, you can find me on any platform.
Yes, you can. You really can. All right, everyone out there in this wonderful listening world, you have it. You have to brave the fears. You have to take any sort of mask that you have off, and you have to just celebrate the gifts you are as a human being, and life will unfold. Thank you so much, Patrick, for being on. It was so much fun.
This was a treat, and I will see you in New York on the 29th. Want to give it to us one more time?
It's 22nd Y Street, guys. So if you're in New York and you want a little bit more balance and you want to know how to keep it, come join us. Come join us. It'll be so much fun. It'll be fun. It's always fun. So for all the listeners out there, take these gems, use it in your life, and always, 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 namaste.
This has been 30 Minute Moments featuring Alena Chapman. If you missed an episode, download it now at wowo.com.
Podcasts by Federated Media.